Okay.
So here's how it reads. So what happens here is what it says is, the Red, White, and Blue partnership, which began with investments by the partners as follows. So Red put in $175,000, White put in $220,000, Blue took $205,000. The operations did not go well. The partners eventually decided to liquidate the partnership, sharing all losses equally. What a relief, that's just automatic. On October 31st, after all the assets were converted to cash and the creditors were paid, only $60,000 in the partnership remained. So compute the capital account balance of each partner after the liquidation of assets and payment of the creditors. Okay, so let's start there. So for part number one, let me make this right here. So what we have here is we have initial investments. So here we have Red, and Red put in $175,000. Okay. We have White, and White put in $220,000. And we have Blue, and Blue put in $205,000. So the total investment was $600,000. Now, allocation of losses. So, in this case, we have $600,000 minus $60,000. That meant the losses were $540,000. Divide that by 3, and since they're equally, they absorb it equally, each will take a $180,000 loss. So, in this case, here's the total equity that was the original investment. Here's what it was worth when it was left. I'm getting that over here. That meant the equity, the losses, the equity decreased from 600 to 540. You share it equally, divided by 3, so it's 180. So 180 comes out of Red, 180 comes out of White, and 180 comes out of Blue. That meant the capital balances after they absorb the losses. Now, Red is down to 5,000. White is 40,000. Now, Red has a deficit of 5. White has a 40, and Blue has 25. Okay? And there's a total of $540,000 loss. And the total equity at this point is $60,000. Okay? So, in this case, in the first case scenario, okay, Red is able to pay the $5,000. So, when he does that on August 31st, so number two, assume. Okay. So that's the first one. Now, why don't you guys do part two? So part two says, assume that any partner with a deficit to pay the cash in the partnership. Okay, so I just did part one. So why don't you guys do part two and then part three? So part two says that any partner with a deficit agrees to pay cash to the partnership to cover the deficit. Present the journal entries on August 31st to record the cash payment of the deficit and the final distribution of cash to the partners. Thank you. so here's what it's like when Red puts in the 5,000 to cover his deficit. Then that brings the cash up to 65,000 because there's only one asset left. It has to be cash. So there was 60,000 cash to begin with. Now it's up to 65. And then the two capital accounts are covered. That sound about right? And then in three, Red doesn't cover his losses. The other two have to absorb it. Let me see what questions there are on this one. How you doing over there, Ben? Thank you, Dory. Okay. Michael, you doing good?
Yeah.
Okay, just checking in. Nothing meant by that. All right, you guys doing good? All right, so in this case, there was a $5,000 deficit. Red covered it. That raised the cash to 65. Now, what they do is, what this 60,000 is the equity, but there's only one asset left, cash. So there has to be 60,000 in cash, and it just went up by five. Then, if you do it, if you go with these steps, the cash will always equal the equity, and everybody just takes out their equity. Now, in three, Red does not cover it, so this $5,000 has to be absorbed by each of the other two, and the cash will remain at 60. So when you lessen each of these by 2,500, it will equal 60. But let me just kind of stop there. You guys ready for some answers, I guess? Okay. Well, here I can do this. Let me put this here. And I'll put this here. So the loss is absorbed by white, Red's loss is absorbed by white and blue. So this credit will wipe out his capital account. Both of these decrease by half of the deficit in Red's. Then the cash remains at 60, and the two reduced capital accounts will also equal 60.
Well, it
has a zero balance. So there's no need. Because what happens when these guys cover it, it simply has a zero balance. So on this thing, in this case, when you close it, all you're doing is you're distributing the assets to the equity.
Okay.
These people are taking assets equal to their equity. And there's just Red's gone bye-bye. Sound good? All right. So let's do this. Let's cover one final topic, and then let's do some practice. We'll do the B version of the A homework. Does that sound like the plan?
Yeah.
All right. Let me go through here. I'll move this around to here, I suppose. And the only final topic on this is the fact that you have a return on. Any questions on this? So you have a return on partnership equity, and again, all you do on this, it's the same as any return on equity. What you do is you take the net income assigned to each partner and divide it by the equity that the partner has. So it's return on partner equity, or it's partner equity return, is that the word, partner and it equals partner net income. And that's how much of the net income was assigned each partner's capital account divided by the average partner equity. Okay. So, does that sound about right? And again, the average partner equity, you take the beginning, add the ending, divide by two, just as you did before. Sound good? All right, why don't we practice one of these and then we'll get on to, so let's do quick study 12-8, page 497. Actually, you guys, do we need any practice with this? Pretty straightforward, isn't it? Jean says yes. Let's go the reverse. Hey, who wants to practice it?
I just want to know what you mean by average partner equity.
Yeah, you take the beginning, add to the ending, divide by two. And the reason you do that is because you always have two annual reports, one from last year, one from this year. Look at last year, the ending becomes the beginning of midnight. Look at this year, that is the ending. Add the two together and divide by two. And that's better than either by themselves. All right, let's do one. 12-8-497. That's quick study. So here's how it reads. Let me kind of pull this together so I can use me. Okay. So it's 497. Here it is in its quick study 12-8. It's down there at the very bottom.
Can you say what average partner equity was again?
Sure. What you do is you get last year's annual report. Go to the balance sheet, and it will have the equity for each of the partners, right?
Yeah.
So, and then you take this year's, and you find the equity for each of the partners from this year, right? So you add the beginning to the ending, and divide by two.
Oh, the beginning.
Yeah, and the reason that's a common procedure is that you always have an annual report. Okay, and so, and last year's at midnight becomes the beginning for this year.
Yeah.
And so, and that's why it's a common practice to do it this way. Now, if you have monthly balance sheets, add them together, divide by 12, and that's even better.
Yeah.
Okay, but yeah, you always have the beginning and the ending, so you always have the annual report. Okay. Sure. All right, so it's right here, it's 12-8. Let me turn the camera around. And so, I'll put that up there. So here's how it reads, basically what it says is, Gibson and Blue's company is organized as a partnership. At the prior year end, partnership's equity totaled $300,000, $200,000 for Gibson, $100,000 for Locke. For the current year, the partnership net income is $5,400 to Gibson and $10,000 to Locke. And the year-end equity were 28 for Gibson, 120 for Locke. Compute the total partnership return on equity and the individual. So the total return, does that sound good? So what you want to do here is for the total partnership, it's the total partnership equity, which is $300,000 plus $400,000 divided by two. So the average total partnership equity would be $350,000. See what I'm getting at?
No.
Well, what you do is you add the $300,000 to the $400,000, which is $700,000, and divide by two. That's the average total partnership equity, right? And then you divide that by the net income, okay, for the year. And the net income for the year is, and the net income, let's see.
$50,000.
And then you do each individual partner. So for Gilson, it'll be $200,000 plus $280 divided by two, so it'll come out as $240. and you divide by his share, which is, his share of the net income, which is 40. Does that make any sense?
Yeah.
All right, let me put up the first one. So here's the one for the total partnership. And it's a similar process for each individual partner. So for the total partnership, beginning equity plus the ending equity add together, divide by two, okay? And that comes out to 350,000. The net income is 50, so that's for the total partnership. Gene, is that making sense?
I'm just a little confused on the average part.
All right, well, what it says now, at the beginning, it was 300,000, right?
Yeah.
And at the ending, it was 400,000.
I just didn't realize that we were doing the beginning plus the end.
Okay. All right, I appreciate your question, because I've never seen it with one person, and you're just kind of a bold person. Seriously, appreciate your maybe avant-garde. Is that better than bold? You're like avant-garde. out there in front. Okay, yeah.
So if you got the equity for the next year, you would just take that year plus the current year and then divide by two, is that
exactly
right?
Okay. Mm-hmm. Yep. And of course, here's what it looks like for Gibson. And here's Lot. Does that make more sense? Yeah, can I check in with you? Is there a...
I get the math, I just don't understand the purpose.
Oh, is it a good investment? So what it says is, like, take that 9.1. What could this guy do better elsewhere? And what it is, you take the level of risk. If this is a really risky business, that 9.1 is a paltry return, right? And if I were Lot, if this is a risky business, I'd get out of it. Suppose, by contrast, it's an ultra-safe business, one of those cash cows. Everybody needs it. Well, it may not be a bad return. So you want to take a look at that and just compare it to the risk you're taking. And that's basically it. Could you do better? Could you find another investment with the same amount of risk with a better return? Is a question you have to ask yourself. All right. And like right now, there was a time when a savings account would pay quite well. You know, a money market paid quite a bit. I mean, now it paid nothing. So now this is, you know what I'm saying? But there was a time when you could get a return like this in a money market account with practically no risk. Now, it wasn't FDIC insured or anything, but, we're talking about pretty safe. So anyway, that's it. It just gives you an idea what it's worth. Okay. Hey, you guys doing good? let's do this. Let's take a short break, and when we come back, we'll do the practice and be ready for the homework. Could you keep an eye on your watches? I'll try to start in exactly 10 minutes.
So he started the year with 200,000 in capital. He was allocated 40,000 in net income. He ended the year with 280,000 in capital. Where'd the other 40 come from?
He might have put some more cash in if he wanted. He could have put like a cash deposit.
That's where I'm like, okay.
Because equity can come from more than just from profits. Or maybe just like, you know, make a deposit or whatnot. Or like, you know,
yeah, but if but if you're feeding your account, then you're getting, you're not getting the right percentage.
No, it would be the 40,000 that's right, you know,
because you're paying your account.
Well, yeah, but you're also making in your economic up, so make sure we turn
200,000.
The wall.
The 200,000.
Nobody really puts anyone in there, it's all accounting system.
Oh, the accounting system will run exactly. I haven't turned that camera. The accounting system will run exactly like this.
Yeah.
So, you use QuickBooks, for instance.
I do.
QuickBooks keeps the books